Hello and welcome to Live a Little Higher. Today we continue with our learning on the Hasidic approach to joy by Rabbi Shlomo Majewski. Last week we were speaking about Ayesh and Bitul. And what is Ayesh? Ayesh is a person that is egocentric and selfish, that is controlled by his ego and his instinctive nature. And Bitul is the opposite of Ayesh, of Ayeshus, which means nullifying the self. It's a person that is selfless, that lives for a higher cause. He's not thinking so much about himself. He's always thinking about what else he can do to this world, what else he can fix, what else he can, what other person he can help, who else he can give something to. And he's not so engrossed in his in himself. So a person that does bitul, I want to make this clear, is not a person that is not has no self-esteem. It's not a person that has no connection to himself. He's a person that has a lot of self-esteem. It's the other way around. Why? Because the true self-esteem is when a person realizes that he is he's not here by his own. He's a person that was really created by Hashem, and he has a neshama that was given to him by God. And this makes a person accountable and responsible for his life. Because when you feel that you're in this world because God put you here for a reason, and you're not an accident of the universe, then you have to live up to who you are. I learned something nice that my teacher Shimona said yesterday. She says real emunah, real trust in God, real faith, is not only that you believe in God, it's also that you believe that God believes in you. And when a person knows, not only believes in God, there's a lot, most people believe in God, but not only that you believe in God, but that God believes in you, this is true selflessness. This is true bitul. Because when a person understands that he's in this world for a purpose and a meaning, and he has something to accomplish here, that Hashem sent him to this world to do something for him, then this is a person that's gonna very much appreciate his own life and his time in this world, and he's not gonna waste it away. So there's a beautiful explanation about how being so engrossed in ourself doesn't allow us to really be productive and joyful. And it talks about a professor of podiatry in a university, and he's teaching his students the movement of the feet and how the feet has all these little bones and nerves and muscles and sinews and all the things that combine in harmony a foot so you can walk. He was teaching the students how everything was connected and how everything made the foot be able to walk. So when he finished the class, he went home and he had all these ideas in his head. So while he was walking, he started getting into his feet and thinking about his feet and how every little thing that he felt should have been this bone, and it should have been this nerve, it should be this and this and this. And suddenly he was so engrossed in the mechanic part of the feet that he could not walk anymore. He became very unstable and he couldn't walk. And he had to stop. And he stopped and he sat down, and for a while he said, no, this is not gonna work. If I'm thinking so much about how the feet work, they're not gonna work at all. Because it's something that is natural in our body. Like, we don't have to think about how to move our hands or how to blink our eyes or how to chew our food. It's something that is natural in ourselves. And when we put ourselves into it, then it's not natural anymore and it stops working. So what he had to do was change his whole thought process. He had to think about something else, and in that way he was able to get up and continue his way home. And there's another story very similar that explains this concept, and it's this rabbi. He's walking down the street and a person says hi to him, and he stops him, and he had a very, very long beard. And the person asked him, oh, Rabbi, I've always wondered, how do you do it when you go to sleep? Do you put your beard under the blanket or on top of the blanket? And the rabbi said to the person, you know what? I've never thought about it. I don't know. I have no idea if it's under the blanket or if it's on top of the blanket. I've never thought about it. So that night, Obviously, when the rabbi went to sleep, he was looking at his beard and he was wondering where should it go? Should it be on top of the blanket or under the blanket? And he was playing with it for hours and he couldn't go to sleep because he couldn't find a comfortable position to sleep. And this happened for a few nights. And he says, how was I able to sleep for the last 40 years with my beard? It never was a problem. Why? Because he was not thinking about it. It was something selfless. He was not thinking about the beard. But once the beard became part of him, and he became so focused on that part of himself, then it started bothering him. So these are two examples of how the self can get in our way, and how we can stop living because of that. And it explains the difference between the Yeshus and the Bitul, also lie in the heart of the difference between the Merirus and the Atzvus. So if you remember when we spoke before about Atzvus and Merirus, Atzvus is two feelings of sadness that are different, because Atzvus is a feeling of self. When you're concentrated on yourself, then you're gonna become depressed, because everything is about you. You're the center of the world. So if that person didn't look at me, then you're sad, because how could it be that that person didn't look at me? Or maybe I'm not good enough and that person doesn't even look at me. So when you're so self-centered, you're gonna fall into depression. But if you are in the Merirus mentality, which is, yes, you get bitter about it, but then instead of getting depressed and thinking about it so much, you just go into operation mode. Okay, what do I have to do to fix this problem? What do I have to do to learn this lesson? How could I be a better person? How could I do more with this? And it springs you into action, and it's not gonna drown you down. And so we see here again that the difference between Merirus and Atzvus is that a person who experiences Atzvus, which is depression, does not think in terms of a practical solution. This is a person that is okay with his life. Like, he doesn't want to change it. He doesn't want to be bothered, because in a certain way, it gives him comfort. Change is hard. Change is painful. Change is looking at yourself in the mirror and saying, oh, there's something really wrong here. I have to do something about it. I have to get rid of this. And the person that falls into Atzvus really doesn't want to let go. And it's not that they don't want to let go of the situation. They don't want to let go of themselves. Because the biggest fear in life is the fear of ceasing to exist. People are petrified. It's so internal. It's in the subconscious. People are petrified to cease to exist. So a person that holds into all these things because of his selfishness and his self, when he's letting go of himself, he's scared that he's not going to be existing anymore. He's going to be lost. So this is what it's telling us. So when a person thinks in terms of how bad it is and how much worse it can get, what this one thinks about him and how he's really not that bad, after all, compare him to his brother or his sister, his cousin or his next door neighbor, there are the sort of thoughts that go through the mind of a depressed person. He's a person that's just comparing himself to everybody, and in a certain way, these thoughts grant him a form of satisfaction, because he feels he exists. He's not non-existent. But a person who tastes Merirus, who has the taste of this, which is a redeeming feeling, it's redemption, by contrast, is motivated to seek a solution to his problems, and he's not self-absorbed. He has committed himself to goals and purposes. He wants different things from life. He wants to change. He wants better life. And he knows he has to work for that. And in a certain way, he looks at what happens in his life and his environment in terms of those purposes. So it's a person that says, okay, if I was mistreated in my life by a certain person, then it's something that I have to learn from. Maybe I have to learn to stand up for myself and get respect. I have to start respecting myself. I have to know to love myself. I have to work on my self-love, but not in a selfish way. In the way I told you about at the beginning of the class, that we are a creation of Hashem, and we should love ourselves because we're part of God, and that makes us holy. But not because of who we are, it's because of what Hashem did for us. So this person will find his faults. He'll be acknowledging what is not right in himself, and he'll be honest with himself and responsible and accountable. And he's gonna be working towards that, and he's gonna be painful. But at the end of the day, he's gonna feel a true sense of happiness, because it's gonna come from him feeling overachieving and feeling hopeful and feeling that he has been able to be productive and being able to fulfill. So the bottom line here is that what causes depression really is our self-centeredness, is our yeshus, is our egos, and the obsession with ourselves. And that prevents the person from focusing on his purpose in life and the intent that God designed for him. Such a person will remain obsessed with himself and will be unable to experience the true joy that comes from a total acceptance of God. And when you come to accept that Hashem is the owner of the world and he's the one that runs everything, he runs the show, and we are just part of his plan, and we just have to be the best we can be with what he gave us. It's our purpose. And then that's when we are able to be an expression of him in this world and live happily, because we're really living up to who we are. And that's the whole secret about it. So I wish you a happy week, a happy, happy, happy. We're entering the month of Adar, which is a month of joy. We have to increase in our joy, live a little higher. Thank you.